Last month, Senator Ted Cruz was the first major candidate to formally announce his presidential bid for 2016. Speaking at a private Christian university, he spoke at length about his family and his faith. But do religious beliefs still inspire voters? As we look towards 2016, what will religion's impact be on the election and our war on religious extremists abroad? Joining me for this discussion is Dustin Berna, associate professor in the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences at Nova Southeastern University. Robert Chalwell, assistant professor of political science at Broward College. He is also an ordained minister. And Joe Holland, adjunct professor in the School of Law, Theology and Ministry at St. Thomas University.
And professor of philosophy.
And professor of philosophy.
That's my main job.
Great. Well, thank you for sharing that with us. So welcome all to the program. Do religious beliefs still inspire voters? And we look at Senator, and the reason I mentioned Senator Ted Cruz is because when he launched his campaign at Liberty University, he said 50% of evangelicals don't vote, Dustin. He said 50% don't vote, and it's because I guess religion matters to them when they make a political identification with a candidate. I don't know if it's true that 50% vote or don't vote in elections. I know in 2012, evangelicals had a difficulty with a candidate such as Mitt Romney because he is Mormon. How do you see it?
You cannot separate religion from politics today for two reasons. The first reason, we could look at it from ISIS's perspective. ISIS has, its main objective is a complete elimination of the United States, and it's an Islamic extremist movement. So religion right there is coming at us. At the same time, the American public wants a president or our elected officials to have some morality and some ethics. And statistically, they want somebody that believes in God. So they simply don't want their religious views imposed on the American population. We don't want their views imposed on us. However, we want them to have faith.
As a moral compass.
Yes.
What do you think?
Well, I think Dustin's correct in that it can't be separated, but I would look at it from a slightly different angle. In as much as religious affiliation is tied to who we know ourselves to be, it's tied to our identity. From our earliest socialization as children of our parents, who may or may not have been religious beings, or grandparents, and then the community that we come from, our whole identity is significantly centered on faith, faith beliefs, faith practices. And so that even suggesting that it's possible to remove religion from politics, to a certain degree, it's a moot point because you can't measure it necessarily. Folks say a lot of things, but you can't measure to the degree that their decisions are being impacted by their faith beliefs. But ultimately, we wouldn't want religion out of politics. Some of the early denominations that were here in America, they supported the ending of slavery. They were the missionaries that educated slaves, that educated Indians in South America and Latin America. And at the end of the day, today, in 2015, they influence and represent a large number, a large segment of the population. And we want their beliefs to be represented in politics as well.
Joe?
I think they're inseparable. 80% of the human race belongs to some religious organization, apparently. Religion is an institution older than the state. It's never going to go away. I think in the United States, I'm a Democrat, but the Democratic Party has a serious deficiency in this area, I think, which didn't used to be the case. The joke used to be that, slight variant, that the Catholic Church was a Democratic Party at prayer. Now, at least with European-American Catholics, as the Reagan Democrats, has been a massive shift over. And I think the question needs to be asked, sincerely, why? What happened? And I think partly it's a deficiency in Democrats. The Republican Party has been very astute, very creative in building on a religious base. I don't always like the way they build on a religious base, but I think they're correct. Years ago in the 1970s, I watched the rise of the New Right, and I began to see the deficiencies in the rise in the earlier New Left to which it was responding. I wrote a little pamphlet called Flag, Family, and Faith, three symbols that there should be struggles over their interpretation, but the people on the left had sort of ceded the terrain and just abandoned those three symbols, and the right wing populistly was able to have an unchallenged monopoly over them. And I think that has been proceeding over the last several decades.
Why?
Well, Ralph Nader's analogy, I don't know, his interesting book out recently about building bridges between right and left, which large institutions don't want to do. They foster hatred between the two. And I think at the base, there's a lot of commonality. But he said largely the left wing, so to speak, is people like me, urban, educated, somewhat cosmopolitan, but there's a tendency to lose roots, lose identity in that. I guess I'm close enough to my Irish rebel immigrant religious experience where religion and society and politics were totally fused.
Well, there is a struggle between church and state, and what is the proper role of religion in society, particularly in the public sector or in government, Dustin?
The American populace were fed up. We're tired. We're tired of both the left and the right. 95% of us are fed up with our elected officials. We're tired that the right our elected officials currently, the liberals, have put us so far to the left we're touching socialism. The right has pushed us so far to the right that we're touching fascism. So the American public is saying, what happened to classic conservatism and classic liberalism, and what has happened to our elected officials? That the political parties no longer represent 95% of us, and we're tired of it. When only 2.5% of the population is represented by the liberals in Congress and 2.5% of the population is represented by the conservatives in Congress. So the rest of us are saying, what about us? What happened to classic liberalism that said that not everybody starts at the same level playing field, so government's job is to help facilitate that, put everybody equal through education and give them a level playing field, and then they go and achieve on their own, and government's not going to carry them through this process. Classic conservatism said that government's not going to get involved in your life. You do as you want. You achieve as you want to achieve. And there's no role in government within the public sector.
But on a federal level, Dustin, no one's voting in that way. I mean, when you see a number of, with the exception of the last election in Congress, you do see that overwhelming trend towards the Democratic Party. So there is a struggle. Or is it, as Senator Cruz suggests, that the more conservative, let's say the Christian right or the evangelicals, as he suggests, just is saying, I'm not going to vote. Go ahead.
Well, actually, I wanted to just touch on Dustin's point about folks being fed up. And I do agree that they're being fed up with the parties. It's because the parties aren't adequately representing where people are. They're not representing the ideologies.
Is it because they're afraid?
It's not because they're afraid. It's because the whole concept of identity was shaky from the beginning. You talk about classical liberalism or classical conservatism. That was somebody's definition of what they were observing and not necessarily what was actually going on. The reality of the situation is that both camps have always been pretty diverse. It's just that as the issues of power politics get ever more intense, they're polarizing because both sides are afraid to cede any ground whatsoever. And so at the end of the day, I mean, I would really love us to have a discussion about power and how it's less about religion and religious belief, but who's actually controlling the helm, who has the reins of power in American society.
Well, does power use religion for control?
I would say so, definitely. Has done it for centuries.
Always has.
Has done it for centuries.
But in different ways?
Yeah.
In different ways, and I would say particularly, and I would, you know, bring in the law at this point and bring in the Constitution, because religion as a source of, a foundational source of identity, is so powerful a tool to influence and control behavior, the Founding Fathers saw it fit to have a separation of church and state. And that relegates religion, religious belief, and religious groups to being a social interest group in our society that has equal right to assembly, equal right to advocate for their positions, but they need to be recognized as an interest group and not necessarily as some predetermining force in American politics.
Joe?
The left wing of modernity has, for hundreds of years now, has had a growing assumption that religion is something obsolete and will be, at least, if not eliminated, at least privatized and marginalized. The right wing of modernity has rebelled against that and tried to defend religion, sometimes in what I would consider reactionary ways. But the whole modern project, I think, we're at the end of the modern world. The end of a long cycle of including classical liberalism and classical conservatism are not adequate guides into what has to be some kind of ecologically regenerative future.
And what would that future look like?
I think actually, this is a little simplistic, but for most of human history since the invention of agriculture, we lived in Neolithic villages. Even when the Spanish crown and Latin America sent a village, you had to have a plaza, this is the way, you had to have the barrios this way. It was designed, Aristotle has the same thing in his book of politics. It's supposed to be designed a certain way. Modernity, be it of the left or the right, liberal capitalism or scientific socialism, just thought that was all wrong. And what's created is a massive urban bourgeois, I don't mean in the Marxist sense, me, I'm a bourgeois person, people live in towns and cities, who have become totally disconnected from the natural world, but not only from wider nature, from the natural ecology of human community and human family. So our families are eroding, our communities are eroding, and the ecosystem is eroding. That's what this new papal encyclical will be about, by the way, by Francis. And for at least Catholic social thought, which is rooted in the truly classical tradition of Aristotle and Roman Stoics and stuff, they're going to go for regenerating ecological, social, and spiritual community holistically. Be interesting to see what happens with the Reagan Democrats who went Republican, if there's some new, Ralph Nader is saying that it will be some new ecological synthesis in politics that we can build around. The only other point I would add, I lived and worked in Washington, D.C. much of my life, our family there, and I founded several national organizations. I found early on, you can quickly raise a lot of money if you define an enemy and attack them brutally. But if you try to build bridges, not too much money comes flowing in. So there's all kinds of people making money and building careers around ridiculing the opposition and fighting each other. And it's extremely destructive and disintegrating.
That's really interesting that you mentioned that, Joe, because I think it goes back to your earlier comment about what you perceive as deficiencies of the Democrat Party. I believe that the Democratic Party has been attempting to build bridges and widen it, the umbrella, the camp, so to speak, is the term that it's usually used, and in so doing, does less of that defining and more of enfranchising?
Well, I would tell you in general, I think that's the intention, but one area that they've really seriously faltered on is on the area of abortion. Mm. I'm not in favor of criminalizing women who have abortions, but from a Catholic perspective, I think it is a serious moral evil. But pro-life Democrats, including Bob Casey of Pennsylvania, whose father was not even allowed, the governor was not even allowed to speak at a Democratic convention, will get almost no support and will be ostracized by the Democratic leadership. At the same time, the pro-life movement, the official pro-life movement, will only give to Republican candidates, so there's control there. For example, the group called Democrats for the Life of America, which has a chapter in Florida, a national organization, they're not in favor of criminalization, but they are in favor of supporting women financially, especially poor women, and helping them. And they propose that they can eliminate over 90% of abortions that way. We know there's a strong correlation between financial crises and abortion. And to approach it positively rather than negatively, but I mean, they are really pushed to the margins of the Democratic Party. So I think despite the intention to be inclusive, and certainly ethnically, you know, and gender-wise, the Democratic Party is becoming very inclusive. But it is generally in the framework of people like me, urban, educated, bourgeois, elites, you know, and the folks in the rural areas and the countryside and in middle America, they're not too good at that, I think.
Yeah. Dustin.
Evangelical Christians are afraid. They're afraid, just like, let's say, gay Americans are afraid. So let's take these two groups. Gay Americans are afraid that the politicians' religious views are going to be imposed on them. Evangelical Christians are afraid that politicians' views are going to be imposed on them. A piece of legislation just got proposed in California that said that it's never going to get passed, but the idea that this was even proposed is frightening, that gays can be taken out and shot by firing squad. It's the sodomite, I can't remember the full name of the piece of legislation, but 99% of evangelical Christians would say that's appalling and would not even agree to that whatsoever. But that's what the gay community is saying, is that we're afraid of this. But evangelical Christians are saying we too are afraid of this. So
evangelical Christians have said, and companies have said, we're afraid of the Affordable Care Act and of its impositions on our beliefs.
Everyone's afraid that their politicians' views, their personal views, are going to be imposed on them. And both sides are saying that we do not want our politicians' personal views imposed on our house.
So, Dustin, when people talk about the importance of religion in their lives and the religion and religion in politics, it's a general moral compass that they're looking for and not any institution in particular. How difficult is that when you look at Jewish communities, you look at Christian communities, you look at Catholic, and by Christian, I mean evangelical Christians, you look at Catholic communities, Muslims. How do you establish that moral compass that people are looking for?
The voter wants a politician who believes in God, who's honest, who's faithful, and who's not going to be dishonest to them. However, they do not want those his or her religious views imposed on them. And if we have to be very careful when we elect individuals who want to impose their personal views on the public, we're going to end up with Iran and have, because the Iranian constitution is copied from our constitution. The institutions are the same, except for they have that religious component. And once that religious group got in control, they were able to manipulate society to keep them in power.
And how much tougher does this get, given the crises that were, and you were talking about ISIS and the threat using Islamic terrorism, which some say is not Islamic at all, it's just terrorism. It's difficult. It's difficult when people feel that religion is being used as a weapon, especially coming from the outside.
ISIS has five objectives. And their five objectives are very simple. The first objective is to create a utopian Islamic, Sunni Islamic state. Objective number two is the complete and total elimination of the United States. Objective number three is the complete and total elimination of Iran, because Iran's Shia. Number four is to move their capital to Jerusalem, which would be a complete and total elimination of the state of Israel. Those are the four main ones. The fifth one's not really all that important. So those are the four main objectives. So you would think that if they want the elimination of the United States, they want the elimination of Iran, and they want the elimination of Israel, the three of us would get along long enough to defeat ISIS, since that movement wants all three of us eliminated.
Well, Robert. Yeah, I do hear the link there with the what's projected as the religious objectives of ISIS. But at the end of the day, in the US context, I go back to James Madison when he was dealing with a group that was experiencing fear. It was a congregation of Baptists, and they were concerned that the congregational church in town, who was the majority, was going to dominate as the local religion. And his response was pretty simple. He says, the structure of the US Constitution is meant to enshrine that the relationship between self and one's God is just that, between self and your God. And the enshrining of this in the separation of church and state was to avoid what we're seeing with ISIL right now. It was to avoid the 400, but could be extended to 900 years of warfare that we saw in Western Europe as the Catholic Church sorted itself out and then the Protestant movement emerged. Our founding fathers recognized that religion, this personal one-on-one relationship with your God, this transformative experience that is to last your entire life and affect every single thing that you do in your life, was not meant to be a tool of state power and sought to separate it. Once the practice of our faith belief, our beliefs, our faith experience, our faith walk starts to harm other people, the law steps in to stop that, or the law should step in to stop that.
Joe?
Two things about the Middle East, and I defer to your expertise. My son is on the National Security Council, my son-in-law on the National Security Council of the United States, so I get a little advice from him. But to my mind, nothing, the U.S. invasion of Iraq, which, by the way, the two popes thought was an immoral war, the second one, but apart from that, once you were in, the most ignorant thing that was done was de-Bathification. Apparently, people didn't know anything about serious Middle East history. The Ba'ath movement was started by Christians in the Middle East to avoid a theocratic state, be it Sunni or Shia. Obviously, Saddam Hussein had hijacked it and other people, but it's one thing is to get rid of him, but to eliminate in the military and the government, to treat everyone in the Ba'ath movement as their Nazis, was to give free rein to a vicious regional war between Sunnis and Shias. Nothing could have been, even Henry Kissinger said, oh, I had no idea that would happen. And Bremer, who was his right-hand man, who was the U.S. ambassador, was the one who insisted on de-Ba'athification when, according to some reports, CIA Joint Chiefs of Staff did not want to do Ba'athification. So what a stupid thing to do religiously and unleashed out of ignorance, I think, not out of malice. The second thing I would say is, we think of Islam and Christians and also Jews always, you know, kind of fighting, but in Spain, in medieval Spain, early medieval Spain, we have the period called convivencia. which, especially in Toledo, there's a wonderful now retired professor, wrote a book about it, The Children of Aristotle. The entire medieval Catholic Renaissance came out of an assembly of scholars, Muslim, black African Muslim scholars, and Jewish scholars and Christian scholars, translating the classical works of Aristotle and others, and that's where Europe then took off after that.
And we're going to have to continue this discussion on another time. Fascinating discussion. Religion does matter. Thank you all for joining me. I'm Helen Ferre. Thanks for watching.